right now, welcome again. We'll be starting in a couple minutes with announcements, worship, and the word. We love you guys. Stay tuned for what we have in store for you today.
Church! Yay! Oh my gosh! Feels so good to say that. Let me get this mask off. Because we're outside, so long I keep my social distancing, I can do this. Well, hey, welcome back to church. This is our second Sunday doing Sunday services, and it's fantastic to be out here with all of you guys. If you don't know who I am, I'm Shelley Traub, married to Pastor Tracey, and we pastor this campus of Riverbank, and there's people out in the parking lot watching out there. Can you guys honk if you're in the parking lot and we can see you? Right on. Thanks, guys, for being flexible. You know, today, like, the governor had a new order that came out that said that you can't, like, sing in your church building because of droplets. But that's okay because we're not in the building, right? So just going to ask us to be safe. Keep your masks on. And if you're singing, just don't sing, like, on top of somebody else. All right? Just don't do that. We'll just be conscious about those things. Okay. So welcome. I'm going to ask Miss Danielle. I don't know where she is. She's around here somewhere. Oh, she's right there. Hi. Sneaking up on me, and little Miss Olivia. Just gonna make a quick announcement for the kids. All you, are you on?
Yes. All right. Hi, everyone. I'm Miss Danielle. If you don't know me, I'm the kids director here at Riverbank. Woo! And this is Olivia. This is my little one. If you are here on site, we have activities for the kids over here at the tent. Just come on over. We have chalk. We have a couple craft projects. Just come on over and grab some things to do to keep your kiddos busy, okay? All right. And I'm going to hand it off, I think, to Grady. Maybe. All right.
Hey guys, super excited that all of you guys are here. Hey, if it's your first time here with us today on the campus, or if it's your first time watching online, we want you guys to fill out a Connect card. So if you're here today with us live, go to the hub where the umbrella's at and grab a Connect card and fill that out. If this is your first time online, hey, we'd love for you to fill one out online. So let us know if you're new so that we can send you that link. Other than that, we hope that you guys enjoy the service today. We are so excited for what God's going to do. At this time, me and Pastor Shelley are going to be up here to share some wins with you guys.
I'm going to stand over here, or I'm going to face this way. Okay, this is good. We're figuring it out. Okay, so some cool things are happening, and we need to celebrate as much as we can. I mean, we just have to, because this is a rough season. So we held our very first blood drive on the Riverbank campus just last week, and it was amazing. We gave 30 pints of blood, 21 people. This was the first time that they ever gave blood ever before. That's so awesome. That's awesome, right? I got to be honest, though. Like, I wasn't one of them. I just was kind of like, I'm a little squeamish. Maybe next time. Maybe I got to work up the courage. Okay? But it was really kind of cool and a little funny is that it was discovered that Grady has power blood. So, just saying.
My wife is not the only person who thinks I'm valuable in the world.
Right. So, he has power blood because of his blood type. So, like, you know, mighty things come in small packages right here. So, if you ever need a kidney or you need some kind of donation, like, Grady is your man. All right? Good job, Gray. Good job.
I'm a blood donor. I'll give you my kidneys, I guess. I guess that's what we were just
told. Don't give two, just one.
I'll give you one kidney. I need the other one to live. This week, we actually had a fireworks booth, and so a lot of people came out and served. We just want to say thank you so much to everybody who came out and served, but we want to tell you the numbers that we raised. And so all together for our campus, we actually grossed over $40,000, and we netted over $30,000. And so as a church, we get to take home more than $10,000 of that. And we will be able to have the actual numbers probably in the next few weeks. But we're planning probably it's going to be around 14,000 to 15,000 that we get to take home as a church.
And all that is slated to go into kids and youth when we open back up. So that's good. Going to have a lot of fun with that. Also, big win is we've been working on that Project Rescue, right? Like COVID has ruined human trafficking in India and in other parts of the world, and that is awesome. And Project Rescue, as you know, reached out, had a need. Like 300 women were released because the people that had kidnapped them and held them in bondage, basically in slavery, released them. And one church, in a matter of 2 weeks, we put out a call, and then we sent a $75,000 check to Project Rescue. That's huge. Every awesome. $1,500 basically sets a woman and her kids up to be retrained and to get health care and all that good stuff. So we did send that out in faith. So if you are not part of Kingdom Builders, we would love for you to join us in Kingdom Builders to give your offering above the tithe to do amazing things around the world. So there is the big win in COVID. Right, is that people are getting set free. That's a big
one. That's awesome.
Okay, so at this time, I'm going to pray over the tithe and the offering this morning. And lots of ways to give, a little different. Giving is a little different.
Right.
So we've got a box at the hub. If you'd like to drop off your tithe, you can do that at the hub. You can give online. You can give on the app. So if you want to give on the app, it's pretty easy. You set it up. But you can also text to give. I haven't done that yet. So if you do that, let me know. Text to give, and you text to 84321. 84321. That's how you text to give. So and make sure that when you give online or if you text to give, make sure you designate your campus. And if it's like your general tithe or it's your Kingdom Builders, so we make sure that it goes all where it needs to go. Okay? And remember, we still are giving through one church. Like, we're changing the world, guys. We just impacted India in a mega way. Let's pray over the offering, and they'll get ready for a time of worship. Father, we thank you that in the midst of what is probably the craziest season of most of our lives, Lord, that we can still come with a spirit of thanksgiving. Lord, that we can still bring a sacrifice to you in our tithe, in our Kingdom Builders, in our worship, with our time, with our talents, God. And Lord, that you are still the God of all hope. You are still the Prince of Peace, God. So I pray this morning that as we give in a new way, whether it's online or through text or whatever we're doing, Lord, that you would take what we give and you would move it through one church to make a difference in our community, in our families, and across the world. And we will always remember to give you praise. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Okay, so we're going into a time of worship. I'm going to ask you guys to get up on your feet. I know we're outside and we got some people driving by. Good, good. Let them see what it looks like to worship the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, because he is our hope. Father, this morning we come before you. We give you glory. We give you praise. We know that you are still the God of all hope, and that never changes. So I pray that we'll be the light of the world, receive this worship, God, and may you get all the glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Count on one thing, trusting in God that never fails. Do not fail me now. You won't fail me now. In the waiting, trusting in God that's never late. Is working all things out. You're working all things out. Yes, I will lift you high. In the lowest valley, yes, I will bless your name. Oh, yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh, yes, I will. Same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now. In the waiting, the same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh yes, I will for all my days. Yes, I will, and I choose to praise, to glorify the name of all names. That nothing can stand against, and I choose to praise, to glorify the name of all names. That nothing can stand against,
sing it out.
And I choose to praise, to glorify the name of all names. That nothing can stand against, and I choose to praise, glorify the name of all names. And nothing can stand against. Oh yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh yes, I will for all my days. Oh yes, I will for all my days. Oh yes, I will. Yes, we will.
Ask that your presence would fall this morning.
I'm caught up in your presence, and I just wanna sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in this holy moment, never wanna leave. Oh, I'm not here for blessings, yeah. Jesus, you don't owe me anything more than anything that you can do. I just want you.
And I'm sorry when I've just gone through the motions. I'm sorry when I just sing another song and take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. And I'm sorry when I've come with my agenda. I'm sorry when I forgot that you're enough and take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. I'm caught up in your presence, yeah. I just wanna sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in this holy moment. I never wanna leave. Oh, I'm not here for blessings, yeah. Jesus, you don't owe me anything, more than anything that you can do. I just want you. I just want you. And nothing else. And nothing else. Nothing else will do. I just want you, and nothing else, and nothing else, nothing else will do. I just want you, and nothing else, and nothing else, nothing else will do. I just want you. And nothing else, and nothing else, Jesus, nothing else will do. I just want you, and nothing else, no, and nothing else, Jesus, nothing else will do. I just want you, and nothing else. Nothing else, Jesus, nothing else will do. I just want you. And nothing else. And nothing else. Nothing else will do. I just want you. Nothing else, yeah. Nothing else. Yes, Lord.
Lord, I thank you that in the midst of everything that we're facing, in the midst of everything we go through, Lord, the truth is nothing else will do but you. Nothing else will see us through. Nothing else will make the difference. Nothing else will bring peace in the midst of turmoil. Nothing else will bring healing in the midst of pain and hurt. Nothing will bring comfort in the midst of trials except for you. So, Lord, we thank you today. We thank you for who you are. We ask that, Lord, you just continue to guide us and direct us. In Jesus' name, everybody said, amen. Amen. You can have a seat this morning. Wow, so good you're here. If you're watching online, thanks for joining us. We are excited that we're meeting live. It's a little different, but we are here. So I'm going to use my phone to hold my papers down. So last week I couldn't see my iPad, so I printed it out. Now this week God decided to turn the page on me. There we go. Now I can do it. All right. Hey, we're going to kick off a new series. I'm going to bring this out here. I'm starting. Kicking off a new series called Don't Drink the Poison. How many like to drink poison? Yeah, I thought so. All right. What's that? That is perfect right there. I need 6 feet distance so I don't get COVID from the poison that's in that. So, all right. And we're going to go through this series for the next couple weeks. Listen, I believe this is a critical series in the culture that we're living in right now. So I want to spend the next few weeks on the subject of living in freedom from offenses and what Scripture has to say on how we are to handle them. Anybody been offended lately? You know, maybe I offended you earlier today. If you were on the setup team, that's possible. It is easy to get offended. It's easy to get drawn in to an offense, right? And anyone lately just been like on social media, you've been drawn into an offense, right? It's happened to me more than once. Here's the thing. The problem is when we get drawn in, and we don't realize the negative impact. We don't realize the consequences. When we get drawn in to an offense, we don't understand the impact that it has on us. See, when there to offense, every offense has two stages. There's two stages of an offense. The stage one is this, and I want you to get this, so I'm going to have you say this after me. But stage one is this, the feeling of offense. So say that with me. Stage one, the feeling of offense. All right? We all feel offenses. Maybe we were overlooked. Maybe we were insulted. Maybe we were taken advantage of. Maybe we were violated or not considered or ignored. We have all felt offended. And guess what? We cannot control the feeling of being offended. It happens. And it happens without you even thinking about it, that we can be offended. Now, stage two of an offense is this. Stage two is the choice to live or not live offended. Stage one, the feeling of an offense. Stage two, the choice to live or not live offended. Let's say that with me. The choice to live or not live offended. It's important that we understand that we have a choice. Many of us are totally unaware of this stage of offense. We assume because we feel offended, it leaves us no choice but to live offended. And so we stay there and we fall into it. The truth this morning is this. Just because someone offends you doesn't mean you have to take up the offense. Okay. We're going to talk through this today, and I know I'm going to probably step on some toes. I'm going to probably offend some people this morning, but I want to go back a little bit to stage one, break it down a little bit. In stage one, that's that feeling of offense. That stage one, when somebody presents you with an opportunity to be offended, they bring you a big old glass of offense. And it's right there in front of you. It's only a matter of time. Listen, it is only a matter of time when somebody's going to do something to offend us. Maybe I did this morning. If I've already offended you, sorry about that. You'll live through it. But what they did, listen here, there's this big glass fence. We understand what they did was wrong. It wasn't right. It wasn't considered. And they served you up a big old glass of offense. And we are humans, so it bothers us. It bothers us that somebody's offended us. and we start looking at that offense and what that means, and we start looking at it from different angles. Oh, yeah. Uh-huh. I see that. Uh-huh. I see what you did there. Uh-huh. Oh, let me get, oh, yeah. Uh-huh. Hey, Scott, come look at this offense. Come look at this, but stay 6 feet away. See? Look at that. See, when we get offended, we start feeling offended, we bring others in so they feel the offense with us, right? Thank you. Thank you. That was quick. That's why you're a DB coach. Ice bath afterwards. We love to just start examining this offense, and we want to bring others in. We don't like to be offended alone. How many like to be offended alone? No, you want to bring people in. You want to have somebody with you. But here, this is where we have a choice. This is where we have a choice, because in stage two, we get to choose whether to live or not in this offense. You see, stage two, to live offended is like drinking the poison and expecting the other person to die from it. No, I'm not going to drink that. That's nasty. It is here in this stage that we go from feeling offended to living offended. You see, there's a big difference between the feeling and the living offended. So today's message is going to be straight up in our faces. It's going to get right into your business, especially with the culture that we're living in right now. So listen, here's the deal. If you don't want to let go of your offenses, you want to hang on to your stuff, you want to hang on to your baggage, you want to hang on to the poison that is killing your life, then this message series is not for you. Thanks for being here. Don't leave yet, but it's probably not for you. Now, if you are here and you're watching online and you're tired of carrying the weight of offenses, you're tired of the poison from within tearing you apart, and you want to find freedom from the offenses, that is the freedom that Jesus died for, then this message series is going to be for you. This message series is going to be right up the alley for you. So here's the big idea of the whole series is this. The choice to live offended, to not live offended, is a choice for a healthy soul, a peaceful mind, and a blessed life. Say that again. The choice to not live offended is a choice for a healthy soul, a peaceful mind, and a blessed life. You see, we have to push the offenses away. We got to fight against the offenses. We cannot take them on. When we are feeling offended, we have to push it away. Even when our feelings are saying, grab that big old glass of offense and drink it because you deserve it. You deserve to be bitter. You deserve. They hurt you. They mistreated you. We have to push it away. We have to refuse to drink the poison. And it's a battle. It's a battle that we can win through the power of the Holy Spirit in our lives. Tell somebody next to you that you need this message this morning. Not them, you, that you need it. She's all telling everybody, you need this message this morning. All right? Now you can look at them and say, yeah, you need it too. All right. All right. That's conviction over there. All right? So this message, don't drink the poison. I want to talk about some truths about offenses. Truth number one, offense is certain to happen. Listen, whenever you are in a relationship of any kind with people or in contact with others, offenses are bound. They are bound to happen. Nobody can avoid them and get away from them. And here's the thing: is what I have found is some of the greatest offenses in my life come from the people that are closest to me. Bless it. Don't be offended. I almost started doing the worm and break dancing, but here's the thing, is a lot of times I find that the offenses that get me the most come from the people who are close. We got to be aware of that because it could tear apart families. It can tear apart relationships. None of us can avoid them. And before we get too pious, understand that we also cause them. Yes, you are offensive to somebody. You have offended somebody. Luke chapter 17, 1 says this. Jesus said to his disciples, offenses will certainly come, but woe to the one they come through. Just because we were offended, a lot of times we get offended because other people don't do what we wanted them to do. Other people don't have the opinion that we wanted them to have. You see, there's so many ways that we can be offended, taken advantage of, ignored, devalued, not considered. But then there are the hot buttons, right? We are living in a culture that is full of hot buttons. And we'll talk about a few of those today. We're not going to get deep into those. But, I mean, you talk about hot buttons, politics, race, gender. All these things are really hot buttons that people are getting highly offended because of. We don't have to go very far to find somebody who thinks differently than we do. Right? You're probably sitting next to him. You're probably married to somebody, hopefully, that thinks different than you do. Right? I know my wife is married to somebody like that. She's great. The guy she's married to, he's, you know. But you don't have to go very far. Matthew 24:10 says that many will take offense and betray one another and hate one another. Does that not sound like our culture right now? Does that not sound like what's going on in our society, in our world right now? Is that people are taking up these offenses. This was written over 2,000 years ago. And they begin to betray one another. They begin to hate one another. This is some straight talk this morning. Let's get our hearts open. Ready for God to bring something new, bring some freedom. The second truth is this. Just because we have the right to be offended doesn't mean we should. Ouch. Well, you don't know what they did. I have a right. This is my business. They stepped into my business. They offended me. I have a right. You know, in our social culture and the environment, people feel justified to be offended by anything that offends them or doesn't match up with their opinion. We justify it. We feel it's okay. Now, don't look so pious, because we all do the same thing. We all justify our offenses. You see, the culture's message to us is this, that I have a right to be offended. It is my right. And I'm going to be offended as long as I stinking want to be offended, because I have a right to be offended. And yes, you probably do. But don't get so caught up in your right to be offended that you fail to see or recognize the cost of living offended. Don't drink the poison. Don't drink the poison. You see, there is a great cost to our mental and our spiritual health. And Scripture points us to a better way. 1 Corinthians 10:23 says, I have the right to do anything. You say, but not everything is beneficial. I have the right to do anything, but not everything is constructive. Another version says, everything is permissible, but not everything is beneficial. The Apostle Paul right now in this scripture where he's writing this, he's talking to these new believers who have been saved through the grace and the power of Jesus Christ. This new way, this new movement called Christianity. They received this new freedom from the law that they had been under for many years. But the problem was is some of them were using their freedom to go do what they wanted to do. and they were starting to offend others, and there became this mess. So Paul was writing to them. Paul is saying, just because you have the right doesn't mean it's the best thing for you. You see, how many are on the wonderful thing called Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, MySpace for some of you guys that are over 40? We're on social media. Our lives are lived a lot on social media. And guess what? When you are on social media, somebody's going to pour you a big glass of offense. See, I got all kinds of friends on social media. I got the extreme left, the extreme right, in the middle, up, down, all around. I love it. And I don't block them or anything. I don't agree with them, and I'm praying through, because sometimes I get offended. It's like some of you probably get offended. But you don't got to be on social media for more than 10 minutes, and you're probably going to get offended by somebody. Or somebody's going to post something. They're going to copy something that they saw from Joe Smith down here down the road, and I'm going to post it, and they don't even know what it says. They only read the title of it. Social media has become a place for many, not all people, who feel they somewhat anonymous to post whatever fits their narrative or their opinion. They don't care who it offends or who it hurts. And I'm telling you, this is on both sides of the issues. Nobody get too uppity up. This is on both sides of the issues. People use social media to pour out a big glass of junk, bashing and attacking people that they don't even know. And if you're like me, you want to respond back, right? I read things on there, and I'm looking at that post, and I'm like, all right, I'm going to take you out. Let's go. Here we go. And I'm like pulling up scriptures. I mean, I'm getting my arsenal ready, and I'm going to just blast them on social media. Then I remember this scripture. Everything's permissible, not everything's beneficial. I have the right to respond to this post. I have the right to defend my offense. But just because I have the right doesn't mean it's the right thing to do. You see, it is permissible as a Christian to speak your mind. The question is whether it's beneficial. As I observe what people post, I'm amazed, I'm shocked, and then I realize I'm feeling an offense, and I'm the pastor, and I just have to shut my computer down. I got to walk away. I got to go pray. I got to go fast. I got to just, you know, I just try to shut it down because it's too easy. You see, here's the thing. As believers, as followers of Jesus, we're called to be a witness for Jesus, to do everything to bring him glory. So maybe the next time before you rebuttal that offense that you got on Facebook, you take a minute to say, Jesus, what would you do? How would you have me respond to bring you glory, to bring you honor? You see, we're called to be his witness. Galatians 5:13 through 14 says this: For you were called to freedom, brothers. Only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for the flesh, but through love serve one another. For the whole law is fulfilled in one word: You shall love your neighbor as yourself. Remember, Jesus brought it down to two laws: Love the Lord your God with all your heart, love your neighbor as yourself. And then Paul brings it all down to one: Love your neighbor as yourself. Love your neighbor as God. You see, freedom will always lead us to a choice. Do we use our freedom to live the life God has for us, or do we use our freedom to fulfill the opportunities of the flesh? I'm going to respond. I got it right. They offended me. You see, when we use it to fulfill the flesh, we inevitably end up back in bondage. Let us use our freedom to create more freedom for us and those around us. Let us use the freedom that we have in Christ to liberate our souls. Truth number three, anyone can give us the opportunity to be offended, but we get to choose if we will live offended. You see, I'm getting, you know, we're getting ready to vote here coming in November, and I'm just telling you, it's already started. The political offense is just serving up a big old glass of political offense every time I look around, every place we look. Now, listen, whether we're on social media, we're listening to the news, or in a conversation, we will find somebody who will whose political views are different than ours. Sometimes I wonder if we all started talking about our political views as a church family, how surprised we might be at other people's views that are around here. How different maybe our political views may be. Guess what? Your political alignment as a party does not define your faith in God. So it would be a little scary. But, you know, we get so offended. I think people would be surprised that there's people from the other party that attend this church than what they belong to. I think some people are going to be surprised in heaven when they see Republicans and Democrats and independents. And God forbid that socialists show up in heaven. But it's going to happen. And here's what I think God's going to do is he's going to put a Republican right next door to a Democrat. Their mansions are going to be connected. They're going to have to share the same water lines or something, right? He's going to mix it up, man. It's going to be funny. And I think he's just going to show that, hey, your political party didn't get you into heaven or keep you out of heaven. I think he's going to mess with us. But listen, when we get so consumed with our political party that we become offended every time some little thing happens, or every little thing's post, and we lose friendships, or worse yet, we become overtly offensive, we're in trouble. We're in trouble. Let's not take up the offense. There was in Matthew chapter 11, 6, Jesus said this, and I'll tell you the setting. He said, blessed is the one who is not offended by me. And here's the setting that he's saying that in. John the Baptist, who led the way for Jesus, who brought Jesus in, was kind of the forerunner for Jesus, ends up in prison. He ends up in prison, and he's sitting in prison, and he's wondering, hey, Jesus, and they're cousins. Jesus and John the Baptist are cousins. He's like, hey, Jesus, what's going on? Are you the Messiah, or should I look for somebody else? And so John sends his disciples to talk to Jesus and ask Jesus, hey, your cousin's wondering what's up. He's sitting in jail, and he hears about you healing people, feeding 5,000, and you can't even get him out of jail. He's like, what up, cuz? And he's like, well, are you the one? Are you really the one? And Jesus starts to explain. And he says, go back and tell John what you're seeing. Tell him not to get offended. Blessed is the one who doesn't get offended by me. And he encouraged him. You see, too often our narratives can be, you offended me. It's your fault. Now I'm offended. And we live there. We live there. But it's our choice. It's our choice. Only way I cannot live offended is if everyone will treat me right and the way I think I should be treated. It's not going to happen. Proverbs 19:11 says, good sense makes one slow to anger, and it is his glory to overlook an offense. To overlook. When's the last time you overlooked an offense instead of responded? Listen, we receive a blessing when we love the way that Jesus loves, and when we overlook an offense that comes our way, there's a blessing tied to it. You see, we are all called to something bigger than a political party or an agenda. We are called to be kingdom people who are kingdom-minded. And you cannot be kingdom people and kingdom-minded if we constantly carry around the offense that we have picked up. Will we drink the glass of offense? Will we drink the poison? You see, here's the thing. If we play the victim, we stay the victim. If we play the victim, oh, you offended me. Oh, I can't believe you said that. Do you even know? Do you know what I'm going through? Do you know what I've been through? And we play the victim, we stay the victim. You see, when we drink the poison of the offense, we are choosing to live with bitterness, anger, and hate in our lives. We can kick some worship music on. I said victim. Here we go. That means I know I'm supposed to wrap up and close so you can get out of the heat. You see, when we live in an offense, we cannot live in the freedom that Jesus purchased for us. Do you have the courage this morning to overlook the offense and instead of drinking it, pour it out? Let it go. Don't hang on to it. Don't even keep the glass around. Pour it out. Get rid of it. Walk away from it. It's easy to live in the offense. You see, Scripture is the opposite of culture. God wants us to walk in freedom. You see, the choice to not live in live offended is a choice for a healthy soul, peaceful mind, and a blessed life. I love what Matthew 6:14 says. For if you forgive other people when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their sin, your Father will not forgive you your sins. You see, our ability to overlook an offense is directly tied to Him overlooking the offenses we create against Him. I don't know about you, but I've offended God quite a bit in my life. Probably this morning, somewhere along the line, I offended God, and I need forgiveness of that. We're all going to offend God, but He forgives us. But our forgiveness is directly connected to our forgiveness here, our ability to overlook an offense this morning. This morning, maybe you're struggling with some offenses that you've already drank the poison, and it's destroying you. It consumes you. It blurs everything you see in life right now. Let me tell you, the antidote to the poison that you have drank is the grace and the blood of Jesus Christ in my life, in your life. That's the antidote to the poison. You don't got to eat charcoal. You just got to go to Jesus. Listen, life is way too short to live offended. Life is way too short to walk around let go. Humble ourselves and listen. We can work through the offense. Today's a new day to lay down the offenses and walk away in the freedom and the blessing that Jesus has purchased for each one of us. You see, freedom starts one place. It starts with inviting Jesus into our heart and into our lives. He forgives us of our offenses. He restores us in relationship with our Heavenly Father. So if that's you today, if you're watching online, here's all you have to do to invite Jesus into your heart and your life is admit that you've sinned. Admit that you have offended the Almighty God, the creator of the universe. Believe that he sent his son, Jesus, to pay the price for your sin on the cross and through the power of the resurrection. And then confess him as Lord of your life. If that's you this morning, I'm going to pray this simple prayer. Maybe you've just been buried under offenses and you have not even been able to see the grace of Jesus this morning. I want to tell you, he wants to pull those offenses away. He wants to raise you up and show you his grace and his love. If that's you this morning, you can pray this prayer in your heart as I pray that, whether you're watching online, you're here, or you're in the parking lot, or you're watching this later at some time. Dear Jesus, I admit that I have sinned and I have fallen short. Thank you for paying for my sins on the cross and defeating the grave through the resurrection. I invite you into my heart and my life, and I confess you as Lord and Savior. Amen. Amen. How many of you this morning need the courage today to lay down an offense? Maybe in this season of social injustice and unrest and political posturing, we've picked up an offense. We've drank the poison. And today you would just say, I need Jesus. I need the antidote. I need the grace of Jesus to overflow me so that I can have the love that Jesus has for those who have offended me. See, here's the thing I'm challenged with. It's one thing for me to overlook an offense. It's another thing for me to forgive the offender. Catch that? It's easy, whatever. You know, I'm going to overlook it. But then in the back of my mind, I got their number. Back of my mind, you know, I don't like that guy. That guy, he's a jerk. That guy don't know what he's talking about. You see, today, do you have the courage to lay that down? Do you have the courage to love the way Jesus loves? 1 Peter 4:8, most important of all, continue to show deep love for each other, for love covers a multitude of sins. Love covers a multitude of offenses. You see, the choice to not live offended is a choice for a healthy soul, a peaceful mind, and a blessed life. If that's you today, would you just bow your heads? I'm not going to embarrass you because I don't want to offend you by making you raise your hand, because that may be offensive for you this morning. So I'm going to eliminate that offense. But you're just going to bow your head, and Jesus knows. God knows exactly the offense that you're carrying, the burden that it is on you. And today, would you just release it to him? Would you just let it go? Give it over to him? And receive the antidote of his grace and his love in your life. Lord, I thank you today. Lord, I thank you for your grace. Lord, I thank you that so many times that I have offended you, you've not held it against me. You have overlooked it by your grace and your love, and you've brought me into relationship. You've restored me to you. And so, Lord, I thank you for that today. And I ask that you would search every one of our hearts. Give us the courage to lay down the offense. Give us the courage to participate in the antidote of your grace and your love for others. So, Lord, that we don't walk around offended. Because, Lord, when we walk around offended, we become very offensive. So, Lord, we want to walk in your freedom. Freedom from the offense this morning. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen, amen.
Good word, Pastor Tracy. Good word. Good word. Whew. I don't listen to his messages before church, or I don't read his notes, so sometimes I come up here and I'm all messed up afterwards. Like, oh, that hurt. Okay, guys, we're going to get ready to call it a morning at church and wrap it all up. Just some things just to maybe help it stick for you today. With freedom, there always comes a choice. A choice, right? We get to decide how we're going to posture our heart. And then when Tracy's like, threw these out, like, I don't know about you, but like that hit me, because then I realized if I'm dumping my offenses out, I get to be like these empty glasses. And I felt like, wow, Lord, what can you do with me now? Because now I got room for other stuff. I got room for better stuff, right? Instead of having offense fill me up, I get to be filled up with other stuff. So I'm just going to ask you to stand. I'm going to pray you out. Thanks for being here today. If you made a decision for Jesus today, or you just need somebody to put some tools in your hand, like, I don't even know where to read, Shelly. Like, go to the hub. Audrey's back there. Angie's back there. They got some stuff just to give you that can help you on your journey. Some really cool short books to help you. So see them if you need prayer. I'll be up here, and I will put my mask back on here in just a second. Be happy to pray with you. If you need information, they'll help you at the hub. We're going to go out this way on the side of the sound booth and kind of just, you know, keep our social distancing as you're packed up. Next week, Sunday, we expect to be back out here on the pad at 9 o'clock. But who knows? That could change, right? So watch for our videos and our announcements on Facebook. But as for now, we'll see you guys next week. Watch us online. Bring a pop-up. Come out anytime after 8:30 before 9, all right? We love you all. You know how to find us. Bless you in Jesus' name. Amen.